Very good evening. I'm Aditi Lama, and you are tuned into Tuesday night edition of South Asian News with Vision of Asia. Today, September 25th, marked the United States National Voter Registration Day 2018. The day saw many volunteers and organizations, along with other national platforms, promote voter registration, an effort to raise awareness in voter participation, especially with the much-talked-about November elections coming up. We urge all our eligible voters to do exercise this right and do remember to register. Casting that vote and having that voice heard is important. On that note, much to showcase you on all tonight's episodes, so let's take a look at the South Asian happenings with the headlines. Jaipur Literature Festival 2018 featuring Shashi, Tharoor and Indian Ambassador to US Navtej, Sarna, Asia Society in New York City. Vibha hosts 5K Dream Mile Run 2018 in Skillman Park, New Jersey. Indian Overseas Congress USA organizes meet and greet reception with Professor MP Rajeev Godkar in New York. More on the other side of the break. Stay with us on Vision of Asia, voice of the community. We'll be right back. And welcome again. I'm Aditi Lamba and you're watching Vision of Asia, voice of the community, our daily news segment presenting you top South Asian stories. Let's begin the episode taking a look at an important event from the diaspora, recently held Jaipur Literature Festival 2018, held at the Asia Society in New York City. The event brought together renowned and inspiring politicians, leaders, writers, and many more influential personalities with a series of panel discussions on literature, art, politics, relations, and much more. Looking at India through the lens of culture, business, and policy, the event featured Indian leaders and politicians such as Ambassador to the US, Mr. Navtej Sarna, and Member of Parliament, Lok Sabha, Indian politician, Mr. Shashi Tharoor. Very engaging event which brought together community leaders, young professionals, and more empowering conversations. Let's take a look at some highlights which also feature our one-on-one with the personalities.
I think it's an excellent development following on the JLF coming to Boulder as well as Houston. This will provide another window into Indian culture, to Indian literature for our American audiences. And I think this is something which builds upon the commonalities that India and United States have together as two open democracies which have been interacting with each other over the ages.
And then the company comes, they send their soldiers, the diamond is taken off to Leadenhall Street, which was the headquarters of East India Company. A former Prime Minister, Robert Peel, falls off a horse and the horse falls upon him and he dies. So that's also attributed to the Kohinoor. So all this bad luck begins to happen. Then comes the great exhibition of London, 1851, where the Kohinoor is displayed. It's displayed very badly. It's just put there, this large egg of a diamond. It doesn't shine. People come, they queue up the streets, look waiting to see it. They are disappointed.
First session was a conversation I had with William Dalrymple on the history of the Kohinoor diamond. I think it's one of the most famous diamonds in world history, and we traced it through the Mughal period, how it went to Nadir Shah, how it went to Abdali, how it went to Shah Shuja, then finally came to Maharaja Ranjit Singh.
Then a real battle began in the Darbar, and the third son, who was Sher Singh, he came. He took the diamond, he took the throne. He didn't live too long. He was shot by the Sikhs, the Attariwalas and the Sandarwalias, who were actually conspiring against him. He was shot. And the boy king, and that's where we come to the story, which was Dalip Singh.
We are very happy to associate with Isha Society and JLF to bring JLF to New York. Amazing array of speakers, all stars in their respective fields. And I strongly urge that people should follow JLF on social media and on the consulate media platforms, so that next time you are there in person to listen to these amazing writers from all over the world, with particular focus on India and various aspects of India and Indian literature. I think JLF is the world's largest literary festival, and we're very happy to bring it to New York.
The Brits came and they said, no, our books tell us that Muharram is a Shia thing. Out with the Sunnis, out with the Hindus, only the Shias will get to run the show. And soon enough, the sniping started from the Sunnis, and the first incidents of Sunni-Shia violence happened under British rule and not under Nawabi rule. Now, this kind of a tendency to want to control, to categorize, to classify, is common to all colonists. It's sort of, you know, the map and the museum are very much instruments of colonialism, and so is the census. So you use the census to ask people to identify themselves along the lines of categories you, as the colonizer, can understand, can classify, and can control. And that's where these monolithic Hindu-Muslim identities began to emerge and became internalized in the consciousness of Indians. It didn't help that after the revolt of 1857, the mutiny, as the British called it, we had also a very conscious effort to divide and rule. The famous memo from Elphinstone, who said that divide et impera was the ancient Roman maxim, and it shall be ours. And with that, you had this increasing consciousness that ultimately culminated after, you know, many stages I've described in the book, in partition. Now, whether we should today still be prisoners of all of these things, I strongly contest. A lot of good work being done by modern historians has established that the actual reality was very different. And there is so much evidence, not just anecdotal, but historically grounded evidence of the community's interpenetration, cooperation, not just coexistence, but going well beyond that, so that you have story after story of, let's say, Hindu temples being destroyed in natural calamities and Muslims coming to help rebuild it. You have Hindus thronging to Muslim shrines. You have the Dagar brothers singing Hindu devotionals. You have all of these elements of cultural exchange and mutuality, which are sought to be denied by this Hindu-Muslim binary narrative that I reject.
I would like to offer Isha Society, as well as Jaipur Literature Festival, to count on Paribhavai Media, our ITV, as well as count on Meet Maskari, and we are always with you and part of the history making. So please do bigger functions next year, and we are with you. Thank you.
So I would just like to take this moment for you to sort of reach out to the audience, especially to the Indian Malayali community, and just give your words of support and encouragement and anything that you want the NRI community to help right now with.
Sure. Well, the immediate crisis is now over, but I guess you could anatomize the whole thing in 4 R's. The first was rescue. There was an urgent need to actually save people who are marooned on tops of their houses.
Right.
There's been an extensive crisis of flooding in about 7 or 8 of our 14 districts.
Yes.
And many people were in dire straits. We had, fortunately, the Navy coming in, Army helicopters, the Coast Guard, and even ordinary fishermen, people who basically live below the poverty line, came out in their boats and saved people's lives. It was extraordinary. We have the rebuilding and reconstruction challenge, which is enormous, because the damage has been extensive. Mm-hmm. 50,000 homes have been destroyed or damaged. 39 bridges are down. 80,000 kilometers of roads were damaged.
Quite a devastation.
All of this, really decades of infrastructure built up in Kerala, will now have to be rebuilt. And that, I'm sorry to say, is what now looms ahead for many years to come.
How important is it right now for you to campaign for your voice now that we're going into 2019?
Well, obviously, I will be campaigning pretty much full-time from the time I get back at the end of this week, or this weekend. Largely because there's no question in my mind and in the minds of everybody else who cares about India, that the future of the country will be very severely impacted by the decisions made by the voters in the next election.
Right.
We have seen, sadly, an attempt to transform in many ways the nature of our country by a government which has unleashed or at least condoned a number of forces of bigotry and intolerance that should have no place in our society. We have seen the onset of phenomena that we hardly were conscious of before,
right,
of the so-called gau rakshaks, the cow vigilantes, the mob lynchings.
Yes.
These are kinds of episodes that have shaken many people's faith in the Indian Republican and the Indian secular democratic experiment to the core. And I think that we do need to stand up for decency and human values in our society. On top of that, this government was elected because it talked a good game economically, but has not been able to deliver. Economic growth has slowed down. Jobs have not been created. We are seeing agriculture in a state of great distress, farmer suicides going up. We're looking at exports stagnating, manufacturing going down. It's a really unrelieved picture of gloom around, and one turns to one's voters and says, have Achhe Din come for you, the good days that were promised by this government? And if they haven't come, why do they deserve a second chance?
I would just like for you to reflect on this huge concept of, you know, India, Pakistan and the Muslim population and how they sometimes do get marginalized in India. You've been very vocal about this, and that's one of the biggest reasons Congress supporters have come up to you on that. I would just like for you to just give us a little bit of insight into that big concept.
There are two different issues. India, Pakistan is a relationship between two states. India and Indians Muslims are a question within our own society. India's Muslims are not Pakistanis, they're Indians.
Right.
And they have the rights of Indians, and they should be allowed to flourish in our society just as anybody else of Hindu or Christian or any other faith.
Right.
But India, Pakistan, the problem unfortunately goes to the very nature of the Pakistani state. You see, in India, the state has an army.
Right.
In Pakistan, the army has a state.
The state, yes.
And the army controls pretty much everything there is in that society, including its government. They ran the country directly with a number of military coups for 32 years, but they also ran the country indirectly when they weren't directly in power, by controlling how much the civilian government could do and not do, and by curbing the rights of the civilian government to actually make peace with India. Every time the civilian governments of the day engaged in a peaceful process with India, the military,
right,
and their pet jihadis were unleashed to stop it.
Yeah.
So Mr. Vajpayee took a bus trip to Lahore in 1999. Within a few months, the attack on Kargil followed.
They did.
We had the issue of the peace talks in Agra. Within a few months, the attack on the Indian Parliament followed. We had a warm and peaceful attempt at dialogue between Mr. Zardari's government and the government of Dr. Manmohan Singh, and then 2611 followed. So every time that peace has been attempted, somebody in Pakistan has had a veto on it through the use of terror as an instrument of their designs. And to my mind, that is a problem that can only be solved within Pakistan. Until and unless the people of Pakistan ensure that the military's malign influence is,
right,
curbed, we are doomed, I'm sorry to say, to a series of this kind of
Let's now take a look at the Indian National Overseas Congress USA, who are actively and engagingly promoting the ideals and philosophy and vision of the democratic pluralist India, representing the Indian National Congress Party, one of India's leading national political party. Highlighting the increasing importance of overseas Indians in the national elections of Indian government next year, the Indian Overseas Congress USA officers and members from diverse community are bringing forth many events and sessions featuring dialogues between leading representatives from the political party and members of community here. With both the Indian government and the Election Commission announcing that the NRI overseas would get to vote in the upcoming elections, NRIs will now have a powerful voice in determining the country's government. With that, the organization recently held a meet and greet featuring Professor Rajeev Gotka, member of the Indian Parliament, Rajya Sabha, and the national spokesperson for the Indian National Congress. Let's take a look.
We are here today hosting our leader, Rajeev Gowda, who's a member of Rajya Sabha, and he is also a member of Manifesto Committee. So today, agenda of the meeting today, so we have to discuss for the future parliament election. Jo election jo aa rahi hai, पार्लियामेंट की उसके बारे में हम डिस्कस कर रहे हैं. इंडियन ओवरसीज कांग्रेस के सभी मेंबर डिफरेंट स्टेट से आए हैं, तो सभी लोग अपना अपना सुझाव देंगे, तो उस पर राजीव गौड़ा जी विचार करके उस सभी विचारों को अपने मैनिफेस्टो में डालेंगे. ये आज का एजेंडा है.
वी आर हेयर टुनाइट एट उत्सव रेस्टोरेंट इन मिडटाउन एंड इन डिनर इन द ऑनर ऑफ मिस्टर प्रोफेसर राजीव गौड़ा. So, and the next agenda is we will discuss for our 2019 coming elections, making more membership for our Indian National Overseas Congress, and how we can work together, and that's what we will discuss tonight. Thank you.
This is one of the new wings that has come up under the Congress President, Shri Rahul Gandhi, and we are here to welcome Professor Gowda and also seek his expertise and learn from him so that we in the IOC are better prepared to win 2019, which we are very keen to.
आज हमारे साथ में राज गौड़ा जो राज्यसभा के मेंबर है वो आए हुए हैं, और 2019 के जो इलेक्शन के बारे में हम लोग मीटिंग करने वाले हैं अभी. सो ज़्यादा करके सारे स्टेट के लोग यहाँ पे आए हुए हैं, महाराष्ट्र के हैं, महाराष्ट्र अपना दिल्ली से भी है, पंजाब से है, यूपी से है, सारे लोग हम लोग मिले हुए हैं यहाँ पे उत्सव रेस्टोरेंट के अंदर. सो वी आर गोइंग टू डू वेरी मच क्लोजली मीटिंग विद द पीपल एंड वेरी सून वी आर गोइंग टू द विन ऑल द इलेक्शन. आई एम प्राउड ऑफ यू मिस्टर राज गौड़ा इज ए फ्रॉम राज्यसभा. सो थैंक यू सो मच एंड आई एम गुड लक टू एवरीबडी टू.
We are looking forward for the session with Rajeev Gowda MP from Karnataka, and we all respect IOC for the inclusiveness and secularism that it stands for, and we are we hope, you know, that Congress will come into power, and we all have to work hard for that in the coming years. For the next year, the Congress should come into power in the parliament.
So this evening it's an honor and privilege to be spending the evening with members of the Congress party overseas, and we have a range of people from different professions who come from different parts of New York City and its suburbs, and they're honoring me with a chance to engage with them on how to strengthen the Congress party and how to improve our prospects in the forthcoming election. I have been here as part of a delegation of MPs brought to America by FICCI, the Chamber of Commerce Association, and I'm at the end of a very, very intense and productive series of engagements in Berkeley, in San Jose, in Los Angeles, and in New York. Just before coming here, I gave a talk at Columbia University on electoral reforms, and essentially this evening we are gathered to reinforce our commitment to India, to the idea of India, which stands for inclusion, for celebration of diversity, for attention to those who are left behind. And this is what the Congress has always stood for and will continue to stand for as we basically take things forward, you know, under Sri Rahul Gandhi's leadership.
Time for another short break. Stay with us in Vision of Asia. We'll be right back. Welcome back. You are tuned into Vision of Asia, bringing you prime South Asian highlights from all across. Concluding the show tonight, let's now take a look at Vibha Nonprofit. With a vision to ensure that every underprivileged child could attain his or her right to education, health and opportunity, Vibha supports over 250 projects in India and 10 in the US, providing opportunities to over 3 million underprivileged children. Their mission is education, empower and enable, and with a great amount of volunteer chapters nationwide, Vibha brings in much support to help the children, hosting various events, fundraisers and much more. Recently, the New York, New Jersey chapter of Vibha hosted its 5K Dream Mile Walk and Run, bringing together a big number of volunteers, supporters and participants.
Really excited to be here to get the opportunity to get everybody warmed up. Thank you, Kair.
Oh, please.
This is an amazing cause. Thank you so much.
It is an annual event. This is our second year. We have more than 400 runners join us. Vibha is a non-profit organization helping underprivileged children in India and in the US as well. And it's going to be a great time.
I'm just amazed to see the crowd again this time. This is our second walk in New Jersey. I'm just waiting for, you know, the winners and people to get this award.
Vibha has raised 17, let me repeat that, $17 million that has impacted more than 2 million children. It also focuses on areas like healthcare, rescue and rehab, care for handicapped children, readiness, job readiness for the youth. It also supports disaster recovery efforts under extraordinary circumstances. Most recently, they have raised $120,000 for Kerala relief. A big round of applause for Vibha and for what they are doing for all underprivileged children in India and everywhere else.
Year's Vibha Walk was completely organized by kids, our youth, and they have all received a President's Volunteer Service Award. They've all been signed by the President of United States, so I'm sure they are very proud about this achievement.
Well, it taught me a lot about leadership, especially how to manage my time a lot better, and it also taught me how to delegate work instead of doing everything by yourself, and it's taught me a lot about how to work in large group environments.
I volunteer for Vibha because you know, I get to help the kids in India, and I feel like we have that special connection, and I feel you can't get that anywhere else, and there's just this special feeling that you get from Vibha and volunteering in general that you can't get anywhere else.
I went around my neighborhood and other neighborhoods asking people about if they wanted to sign up for the 5K by telling them that it's for a good cause and all.
So I've gone to Mumbai and I've seen the shelters and I've seen those kids and I've seen how they get treated outside and how we treat them inside and how much better their life is when we're in it. And I just want to be able to spread that impact as much as I can.
So what impact was it? I mean, what was the difference in their lives? Did they go back to the schools where they drop outs?
Yeah, so a lot of them do succeed, and a lot of them, like, so we give them food, we give them shelter, they just leave an overall better life. They get an education in like three different languages in Mumbai, and it's just a really great experience for them in terms of like building their just all of their life skills.
Great, thank you so much. So I'd just like to tell the viewers that we really welcome you to join Vibha. You can email us at volunteer@vibha.org, and you can join these kids, make a difference, kids making a difference in the lives of kids. That's what Vibha is all about, empowering kids, empowering anyone who wants to make a difference by joining us.
It's been a great experience. I'm really enjoying it. It's a great day. Obviously, coming out here to support Vibha, which is an amazing charity. It gives us a chance to do something for, you know, it's just some way to help, you know. And a great day, spend time with the family, and just be here.
Vibha is a non-profit organization. We've been helping
kids in need for a very long time. We've been 25 years old now. We raise over $1 million a year. We invested around 17 million so far. And the big part about the organization is it's completely voluntary, volunteer driven. We have more than 2,000 volunteers and we've done a phenomenal job. And right now, this New York, New Jersey area has done a phenomenal in the last 2 years. We've had many events, including blood drives, including the race, including Vibe, and just a spectacular turnout of people today. So very, very happy. And as you can see, a lot of people are here and enjoying the moment. But the most important thing, all the funds that we collect are going for children in India to make a brighter future for them. So that's where we are, and please help us grow.
Our segment for tonight. Send us your suggestions and events, and to get your voices and organizations on our show, write to us on events@itvgold.com. Follow us on our Facebook at @itvgold. Remember to also log on to our YouTube page to watch many of our shows for free. Thank you for joining us tonight. This is Vision of Asia, and I am Aditi Lamba. Take care and be well.